meeting between the Finance Committee and the Education Committee of the Senate. And today I thought we'd get an update from Mark Perrault about the state of the Ed Fund. If you've been paying attention to any of the news, it's definitely feeling better than it did when we went home in June, as are most of the revenues, but we're not out of the woods yet. So Mark, why don't you bring it up and tell us what we're looking at?
Okay, so I'm Mark Perrault from the Joint Fiscal Office. Since it's been a while, since most of you have had a walkthrough through the Education Fund Outlook, I thought I would just start off by very, very briefly just recapping where we've been since the legislature recessed back earlier this year. For those of you who follow the Education Fund, and those of you who probably don't, you know that normally education tax rates are set so that the education fund is in balance and we have a full stabilization reserve. This year, post-pandemic, because we had a dramatic decline in the non-property tax revenues that go into the education fund, that would have resulted in education property tax rates that the legislature just deemed to be unacceptable. So what was decided back in Act 122, when you were last in session, was to set the education tax rates based on four things. The first was voter-approved spending for FY21, which had been conducted during town meeting week prior to our understanding what was going to be happening with the pandemic. The January revenue forecast, which again did not reflect any of the revenue downgrades that we saw subsequently. A projected surplus in the education fund at that time, which was about $13 million, and significantly a full stabilization reserve. So with all those pieces put together, we ended up with tax rates that went up from FY20 to FY21, only a little over 3 cents. And education property taxes grew, but only about $60 million compared to where they would have been. The downside of all that is what that meant is we weren't fully covering education spending in FY21 based on the estimates. And there was a significant deficit that was going to be carried from both FY20 and FY21. At one time, that deficit had been as large as $150 or $160 million. That was based largely on the early revenue forecasts that we had that were based on really sketchy epidemiological studies and a lot of conservatism on the part of the estimators. That, as the chair mentioned, that deficit has now dropped dramatically. I can use the education fund to show you how that's happened, but the bottom line is that deficit that was initially anticipated to be as high as $150 million is now $66.4 million, with some caveats, which I'll go over in a second. How we got to the $66.4 million, Faith, can you page down to the bottom of the outlook? I think I'll just hit the bottom highlights of this. So FY22, which you can't see the header, but the middle column is FY20. At one time, we were even anticipating a shortfall in FY20 because of the downgrade in the non-property tax revenues to the education fund, which are primarily sales tax. However, after the FY20 closeout and the more recent revenue forecasts we had, we actually closed FY20 in pretty good shape. You can see on line 27, we have a 4.5% reserve. The statutory target is 5%. So for FY20, we're only about $2.5 million short of having a full reserve. So rolling into FY21, we're not in that bad of shape. However, as I mentioned, the tax rates were set in FY21 at a level that did not fully balance the fund. And you can see that over on line 30, you can see the $66.4 million shortfall. There's a few things to keep in mind with that number. Let me back up a second and just tell you the other changes that came in. The most recent changes that happened in here, and the reason that this has dropped significantly very recently, is that the last revenue forecast indicated that non-property tax revenues coming into the fund were up by $11.8 million. And on top of that, We had been carrying a zero in line 22, which is prior year reversions. And finance and management has indicated that they expect to be able to revert $14 million to the education fund in FY21. Those are from prior year appropriations. So those two significant impacts, more than $25 million, brought that deficit, projected deficit in FY21 down to that $66.4 million. It's important to note that that deficit assumes that we have a full stabilization reserve. So if you look on line 27 again, you can see that for FY21, we have a 5% reserve of $38.2 million. That money, we normally don't try to use that money, but it is available. And we had at one point, well, we did actually, in FY20, you can see we used that $2.5 million. So that money is potentially available if you're unable to close that $66 million gap in FY21. The other really big caveat is that this does not include yet in FY21 any of the pandemic-related federal aid that we are expecting to get or we have got. So back when you were in session in the Q1 budget, you appropriated $50 million of the state's CRF allocation for K-12 education. That included money for $12 million for summer meals, $6.5 million for indoor air quality, $1.5 million for independent schools, and another $1 million for accounting and technical assistance. That left $29 million for the local education agencies, our school districts, to use to offset either new costs that they were facing that had not previously been budgeted or budgeted costs that were eligible for using CRF money. And that $29 million, I know that the agency is here today and they can talk some more about it, but that money is available to school districts. It's possible that some of it may be available to reduce the deficit. It's also likely that a significant amount of it is for new costs that weren't previously budgeted. But in addition to that, this $50 million, which includes this $29 million going to school districts, the legislature indicated at the time when you were here last that you wanted to reserve $100 million of our remaining CRF allocation to provide for additional assistance to school districts, thinking that when you came back in August, we'd have a better idea of how much money districts actually needed. The guidance that AOE has sent out to school districts indicated that that was the case. And I think that most school districts are under the impression that any CRF eligible expenditures that they have in FY20 and in the first half of FY21 would be eligible for reimbursement. It's likely that those reimbursements are going to exceed the $29 million, which only amounts to between $500,000 and $600,000 per SU. So it's not a ton of money when you spread it out over the whole system. However, in the restated budget that the governor just released last week, they have recommended appropriating all of the state's remaining CRF allocation for purposes other than K-12 education. Most of it, about $133 million, is going to ACCD and out to support businesses. So to the extent that money is not available to reimburse schools for some of their CRF eligible costs, and they've gone ahead and spent that money, you could actually see a deficit showing up in school budgets. So the legislature has to weigh in on that. The CRF allocations have to be appropriated. So that's going to be something that you're going to be looking at. The other big piece of money that's missing from here is about $28 million that came through ESSER money. I understand that Brad's going to address that, so I won't spend a lot of time on it, other than to point out that how that money goes out may still be pretty uncertain. There was a court case last week in Washington State that issued a preliminary injunction against the US DOE rules that had been issued several months ago as to how districts could allocate that money. So I won't get into a lot of more detail on that other than just to say that I think it's uncertain at this point. And I think, unless you have any questions, I think that's it. I mean, the good news is that the deficit's significantly smaller than we anticipated initially. We do have some federal money available to have help chip away at that. And that's about all I can tell you at this point.
Okay, committee, any questions? And there we go. You're all back up. Questions for Brad at this time. Senator Baruth, and then Senator Pearson.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Mark, I'm just wondering, is there any downside other than not having a stabilization fund if we were to use that 38 million or whatever it was to close the deficit and we actually zeroed out the reserve there? Are there any downsides, as there might be with, you know, elsewhere in the budget if we didn't have stabilization reserves for credit rating or other
things? I'm not sure about the issue about credit rating and that kind of thing. I'm assuming it's better to have money in there than not. But one practical consequence is that when the tax rates are set in the December 1 letter for FY23, that reserve would have to be fully restored. So at 38 million, 8 million a penny, it's probably 4 or 5 cents on the tax rate that would be added to that recommended tax rate. But other than that, I don't think that there is any huge downsides to using some of that money to offset some of the.
Thank you.
I assume we could change the law to say we didn't have to reflect it or reflect all of it.
Well, I mean, that's in fact what happened this year. I mean, you dipped a little bit into it in order to balance things out in FY20, but only to the tune of $2.5 million. If you were to use the entire amount, I'm not sure how that would be perceived.
That would, okay.
And people who loan us money, yeah.
I know we have drawn down some of it in the past. Okay, Senator Pearson.
I think I have a similar question. The federal money that you said has already gone to schools.
It hasn't gone to schools yet. It's gone to the Agency of Education.
Okay. But schools are spending in anticipation of that. Yes. And then we also, is the money that's gone to the agency, is that, I've forgotten the term. There's two tranches of federal money, right? There's what we sent from CARES money to deal with HVAC and stuff like that. Then there was direct money.
Right, so there are two accounts. One is the CRF fund, the Coronavirus Relief Fund. And out of that fund, you appropriated $50 million for K-12, but $29 million of that is going directly to school districts. There was also some $12 million for summer meals. The other pot of money is the ESSER money, which is actually a lot more flexible, and there's $28 million there. Neither of those pots of money are reflected in the FY21 outlook I just showed you.
Okay, so that helps me frame my question. So is that $28 million something we could effectively back out of this spreadsheet? Or is that got conditions? I mean, do they also have to prove that it's sort of COVID-related expenditures? Do you see my question?
Yeah, they do. They do have to meet all the requirements of either the CRF or the ESSER federal guidelines for spending that money. Whether or not we can recapture any of it and use it to chip away at this deficit depends on whether the money was previously budgeted by the school district or not. If it's new costs that haven't been reflected in the spending, then it doesn't do anything to reduce the deficit, but it does assist school districts in going forward and trying to reopen and that kind of thing.
Thank you.
But anything that isn't funded, any expense that is a COVID expense that isn't covered with COVID funds is, barring intervention, going to fall to the tax rate?
Yes.
Okay. So, and didn't we put, Senator Perchlick is here, I've heard it was his idea, $50 million in for Efficiency Vermont to help schools with air quality?
$6.5 million of the $50 million that you appropriated for K-12 is earmarked for Efficiency Vermont and indoor air quality. My understanding is that that money was slow getting out. So I don't know how far along districts are with that.
I heard it was authorized last week.
Yes. Efficiency Vermont is going to come back and report to you on September 15th as to how they're doing. But given that's only, I'm not sure how far along they'll be.
That's unfortunate, because I was listening to the person from the Harvard School of Public Health who's been writing all the COVID, you know, return criteria. And he said wearing masks and air circulation were the two key ones mm-hmm. for schools. So given some of our antiquated air circulation systems, that's going to be unfortunate that money didn't get out there earlier. Okay, any other questions for Mark? Senator Ballant.
Actually, it's a question for Andy, so I'll wait.
I had one more issue I forgot to mention. It's a small point, okay. But the administration's restated budget also proposes to put the community high school in Vermont back into the education fund where it was back in 18. It's gone back and forth a couple times, but that would increase the deficit in the education fund in FY20 by $3.3 million. So it would grow to $69.7 million. I'm not sure whether that has legs or not, but that's part of the administration's proposal.
Considering we started with a deficit of $171 million and we're down to 60-something decimal dust. It has been kicked in and out. Right. And there's deficits in both the ed fund and the general fund. So, okay, I'm going to move on to Secretary French. And I think what we were looking for is an update, funding, expenses. Is the $100 million that we set aside to cover school opening expenses there? Is it going somewhere else? Just what is happening? Anything you could throw in on broadband and daycare would also help. I spent this morning on daycare.
Yeah, good morning or good afternoon. Sorry, I'm just choking down my lunch really quick.
That's okay. Mine will be here soon.
Yeah, just the press conference went a little longer than I thought it would, but it's good to see you all. Yeah, I wish I had more answers than questions, but let me give you a recap and I invite my staff. We have Bill Bates, our CFO, and I think Brad James, our finance managers, perhaps still on as well. I think in terms of, you know, Senator Pearson's question, and just to clarify, there's, you know, I would agree there's two basic pots of federal money at play, the CRF, which the legislature appropriated the $50 million, and then the ESSER funds. One distinction I would draw, as I understand, is the CRF is a reimbursement process, so districts have to expend those funds, then seek reimbursement. So a couple times in the last few minutes, people have been referring to money going directly to the districts. It's more of a reimbursement. On the ESSER, on the other hand, is a direct allocation to school districts. So they do have to write up a grant strategy proposal, so to speak, and get it approved by the agency. But that's basically a direct allocation to them. In the CRF funding, in our proposal with the legislature, that was worked out to approximately $50 million back when we made that proposal. It was based on a national model that was put out by essentially the National Organization of the Superintendents Association and their counterparts in the school business officials, about $490 a head. That worked out close to our $50 million number. Back at the time when we were proposing this, albeit no one had experience in what the true reopening costs would be, you know, we thought the legislature appropriated sufficient funding for reopening costs. Unfortunately, it's taken, I don't know the answer, I guess the question is that sufficient for reopening? I will say it's taken us longer than we had hoped to get that money out the door. In terms of the CRF application, once again, that's a reimbursement process. So districts just had availability to that as of late Friday evening. So they're in the process of now drawing down or submitting reimbursement requests for those funds. Included in the 50 is this, I think, as Mark mentioned, the $6.5 million for HVAC. I would say that's clearly insufficient to address the broader HVAC conditions in schools, but I'm not quite sure that was the intended purpose per se. I think this was designed as sort of a placeholder to get some of the work going. But I was talking, for example, with the school district Wyndham Central Supervisory, in which operates Leland Gray and Newbrook. superintendent yesterday was saying, you know, they have HVAC situation there that goes back many, many years of deferred maintenance on the part of the school boards and so forth. So it's not something they would have been able to address this summer. It's just something they want to start the planning process in. And that deficiency of having adequate HVAC has resulted in them opening school in a totally remote disposition. So, you know, districts have some flexibility in how they're navigating some of these issues. I will say in the one area we do have direct numbers to report on is the food service reimbursement. I think there was an allocation in the $50 million of $12.5 million. I think as of last week, once again, this is a reimbursement process. We received about $2.2 million worth of reimbursement requests on that. So to give you some sense of how that's playing out. I think, you know, districts, if they had been able to go back a little farther and seek reimbursements, and those probably that number would have been larger than we anticipated. And there's certainly going to be ongoing costs, you know, in the food service operations. But, you know, a lot of the mechanics around the CRF in terms of requesting reimbursement, districts also know those funds essentially are not available after December. So there's that sort of compressed time frame also for them to consider. The ESSER funds, on the other hand, that application's been live since July. But as Mark alluded to, there's been sort of a national debate around this thing called equitable share provisions, which basically the US Department of Education introduced a new methodology by which districts are required to determine how much of that money they should share with their independent schools in their region. And as Mark mentioned, there was an injunction issued, I believe, late in the week, last week, out in the West Coast. As of yesterday, we're kind of convinced that has broad national applicability, but we haven't finished our legal analysis on that. So at any rate, the ESSER application has been live for a while, but it also has been caught up in sort of this political ambiguity. I would say the other piece of the political ambiguity for school districts is that we've had this sort of open and transparent conversation about a clawback approach. So I've heard from many business managers would say, like, you know, we've had access to this application, but we're concerned that if we spend it, we'll also ultimately have it taken away from us in the shorting of the ed fund payment. So I would just throw that in the container of the political ambiguity that's influenced district behaviors. My impression right now is that districts have adequate liquidity to reopen school. And that's really, when I say liquidity, I mean cash flow. Only had one district this summer run into that issue, and that was really a function of them in unable to secure short-term loan as a result of not having an approved district budget. They've subsequently attained an approved budget, so I think they're okay at the moment. But I think cash flow-wise, people are doing fine. The question of what costs are ultimately going to be reimbursed, I think, is still uncertain. And I think, you know, for the moment, our focus is so much on just the reopening of schools. Don't want to lose sight of what will no doubt be longer financial effects of the emergency that districts will have, which will no doubt necessitate further federal support. But I think, you know, just to summarize, we did have some conversation with Joint Fiscal earlier in August. And I think from our perspective, just from a technical perspective, we're fairly convinced that neither the CRF or ESSER funds could be used to address the deficit in the ed fund. We haven't found an easy way to do that yet. I think, you know, our strategy going forward, we're certainly very pleased and optimistic that we've been able to reduce the deficit since the gloomier projections that occurred back in the spring. Our approach right now, in the immediate near term, is to certainly work with our congressional delegation to get more flexibility and more funding, but also to work with districts very closely in the coming weeks as they start preparing their budgets for next year. We think, you know, sort of taking a really intensive approach in terms of sharing information and the tax implications of their decisions will be really helpful as we try to close the gap, if you will, on this deficit. Why don't I stop there and I'll invite Bill or Brad to add on. I don't know if Brad's still available or not. I don't see his face. But...
questions?
More questions. French.
I'm not seeing any. Senator Harding.
I was going to, if there isn't a question, just...
No, Senator Harding has a question. She was muted. There you go.
Yeah. Thank you, Senator Cummings. Secretary French, I'm just curious, when we allocated this $50 million, which is now the 29 of the 50 million that was supposed to be for reimbursements for school district, my understanding was some of that was supposed to be for reimbursement of FY20 costs. So the things that they spent in the spring so that they could close out their FY20 budgets, hopefully with a surplus in some cases and carry forward that surplus into FY21. But because AOE hasn't gotten the funding out to school districts, many of them are in the process or have already closed their FY20 books. So that isn't going to be possible or will be much more difficult. So I know that everything had to be rushed this summer. I'm just curious why you haven't gotten the funding out yet to school districts.
Yeah, I think, it, you know, certainly it's taken us longer than we had hoped, but if I remember correctly, you know, when the legislature finalized this approach, I think it had a retroactive date by which we were supposed to produce guidance. I wanna say June 26th. So the following week it came out or passed, and then you had already put a retroactive, I don't know how we were supposed to comply with a retroactive date in that regard in terms of producing guidance. But I know internally it's been more complex than we thought. And even if I make the observation, like on the ESSER rollout at the federal level, it took the federal government about 4 weeks on an accelerated basis to produce the guidance and so forth to turn on ESSER. It's more or less what we've been working with CRF, though I would argue it's more complex because this was a cross-state government, and we've had to work closely with the financial management team to make sure that our application conforms, you know, tightly to what the required uses are. I think we were about a week behind where we thought we would be, and then as we were trying to put together a response for the childcare needs in particular, we went back and took another week to make sure that childcare costs, particularly childcare costs for teachers, would be an eligible CRF reimbursement. So we took another week to make sure that that was included. But it's been a challenging process to put together while we're putting everything else together. So I hope people didn't have the impression this would be turned on immediately. So it took us some time to do.
And in the process, the governor has not recommended using any of the $100 million that we, the legislature, quote unquote, fenced off for higher or for K-12. And I'm curious as to why that is and what role you played in that, because clearly there are going to be more than $29 million of costs for schools to reopen.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I think, you know, once again, the national model was somewhere, when we applied that to our initial proposal, was around $42 million. And that would include, you know, we're parsing the $50 million into $29 million versus, you know, the $50 million pot. But based on the national model, the total pot, including things like HVAC, foods, everything's in that sort of national model. So we thought our initial proposal, $50 million, would be sufficient, and haven't seen anything else that would prove otherwise, but albeit I would say our approach is on reopening costs, not the larger impact of the emergency. But the issue I was going to mention, the $100 million took me by surprise. And Jeff Francis sent a letter, I think he sent it out broadly to members of the legislature as well. You know, and I heard it a little bit, I think in Senator Pearson's or one of the other senators' remarks that, you know, the legislature, General Assembly had promised $100 million. That never came from our proposal. I mean, we had focused on, and I have the slide deck that says, you know, somewhere around the $50 million. So I'm not sure about the $100 million proposal or promise, if you will. We certainly have, in our guidance, I think, as mentioned, are committed to ensuring that districts have what they need to pay for their reopening costs and the cost of the emergency. I saw in Jeff's letter, and I observed as much with the superintendents, I saw sort of a mix of those two issues. The $100 million wasn't anything we necessarily pledged to, but we're certainly keenly focused on ensuring districts have what they need to reopen. I think the reopening costs, you know, I think it, because the CRF funds are a reimbursement cost, it isn't so much putting cash out the door, it's waiting for those requests to come in. It's yet to be determined whether that will be totally adequate. But I think, you know, we're still following the national model, which puts you at $50 million. And I think the legislature was generous in that regard. And I would also say, we also know they have ESSER funds available as well, which have been available since July.
Okay. But if we don't have money set aside, if the costs run over, we don't have any way to pay for them.
Yeah, I mean, to your point, Madam Chair, anything ultimately that we don't have federal dollars for is going to come out of education spending. So we have to be very careful. I mean, the federal, we need to get greater flexibility, certainly, I think, in federal dollars, but we're going to need additional federal dollars. I feel pretty good about reopening costs, even though, as I mentioned, some of the HVAC issues are longstanding ones in the state. Mm-hmm. I think where we're going to see a significant uptick in costs is in student support services, which also comes out of the Ed Fund. So we need to anticipate, and this is going to be the real challenging piece, I think, of district budgeting, because the first part of that process is going to start here in a couple of weeks, where the special ed directors start preparing what they call service plans, which is a projection of what next year's special ed costs will be. I don't know how they're going to begin to do that, so I want to work very closely with them as they're preparing those budgets.
House is on fire.
Yeah, it's Barry. I'm in my apartment in Barry. I'm sorry. It's a regular occurrence here sometimes.
Fire, yeah.
Yeah. But I think, you know, that we're going to, you know, not to conflate the issues, when reopening costs are not the long-term financial costs of this emergency in education.
No.
And those costs are going to be significant for sure.
Okay. And I think that's, as we go forward planning, what we need to start figuring out. I spent this morning listening to plans for childcare, and I said then that my panic button was rising, that we've got 2 weeks left, and I don't know how any parent knows what's going to happen to their kids in 2 weeks. So,
yeah, and in childcare, as I saw the article this morning too, it's also about staff availability. So we
Yes, I asked that.
Yeah, it's not like you can just appropriate the money and suddenly we have a childcare workforce, you know, or infrastructure. So, you know, some of these issues like HVAC, childcare that we had issues with prior to the emergency are just being exacerbated as a result of this. So it's very challenging. I mean, it's hence the nature of an emergency. But I think it's so much of what I've been, you know, my personal mindset now as secretary is really focused on reopening schools. And I think, you know, last spring when we were admiring the complexity of this financial, we all knew this was going to be a very challenging dynamic. But in some ways, it gets very simplified in an emergency because you focus on, you know, putting the fire out first or dealing with the most immediate thing in front of us, which is right now reopening schools. And now we're shifting pretty quickly into this conversation that we knew was coming, was how are we going to ultimately pay for it? And then going out a year further, which many are thinking will be even more challenging. But I think, you know, the immediate good news is that the deficit's much smaller than it was. We can manage this situation, I think, where the other one was.
Small gifts that we have. Okay, any further questions? Senator Baruth.
Thank you, Mr. Secretary. I'm wondering, as I remember, there was a deadline in the legislation we passed somewhere in November, and it presented an opportunity if money that we had put toward a certain purpose, for instance, the HVAC, $6.5 million, if it wasn't expended by that point, it could be moved out of that purpose and repurposed. So one of the concerns I have is that we have 4 weeks now or 5 weeks, then we will adjourn and it will basically be the administration and the joint fiscal committee that are making those reallotment decisions. So I was not, honestly, not encouraged to see that the governor's budget didn't allow any of that $100 million for K-12. So it's my hope that AOE, the legislature, and the administration can get on one page about making sure that there's a commitment. You just stressed that the commitment on the $100 million didn't come from your agency. That is true, but I'm hoping that before we leave in September, we can all be on one page about making sure that there's money and that we're not going to short K-12, say, in favor of $150 gift cards to go out to Vermonters for random purchases.
Yeah,
just
I mean,
a little comment.
No, I think, you know, to my comment about the political ambiguity, you know, to our credit, we've been talking openly with the field about, when I say the field, I mean school districts, about the potential for clawback, because that was a very real strategy. And I think it's important that we communicate that very transparently to people. That's given them a sense of unsettledness, if you will. And I think the more we can get on the same page through September, the better position they'll be in. That's one less thing they don't need to worry about. But it is, it's also, I would say, in fairness, it's the nature of you know, the emergency. This is a complex issue, and we're addressing issues as they emerge. And I think, fortunately, we've also been able to get out in front of that to a certain extent as a state, because we've achieved a high degree of suppression. But the financial implications are, you know, going to be with us for a while. But we certainly would welcome the opportunity to get on the same page.
I think any talk of clawback has really been, if money can be paid with CRF or ESSER or something else, if we don't find a way to fill that deficit, and, you know, going forward, none of us know what it's going to look like. We're going to have long range costs. It's going to hit the property tax. And I think we know this and next year are not going to be the time to hit people with a major property tax increase. Even if it starts to get offset by rising values. But I think it's not going to help schools either if they come out next year and are looking at a 25-cent tax increase. So we're trying to find that balance. And I would hope we could work in partnership. We all want to make sure that we use as much federal money as we can, and to keep as much cost off the backs of property taxpayers at a time where they may be particularly vulnerable. So I hope we're all trying to go in the same direction. Other questions? I don't see any. So thank you. I'm sure this will just be the start of many discussions. I've got Bill Bates next. Bill, do you have anything to add to this? You're muted.
Sorry.
There you go.
So I echo what Secretary French has shared with the committee today, and then to the extent that we have specific questions on ESSER or CRF, we also have Brad here that can dive into the more granular detail. I wanted to just point out that with CRF, that has a very short tail. So that's the money that we need to use it by December 30 of 2020, or we have to return it. The ESSER money has a longer tail, so there's more flexibility. And I know that in our guidance, we're suggesting that the field prioritize the use of CRF and then use the ESSER money thereafter. Brad, anything else to add to that?
Okay, well, if no one has any questions for Bill, I'm going to go on to Brad. And I'm looking at my screen. Where's Brad?
I'm back.
I love these screens. You're there now, and the next time I look, you're up there, and I can't find you.
Well, I disappeared for a while because I lost the internet.
Happens to the best of us. I asked Brad to come talk, and I guess it must have been joint fiscal that you gave the presentation to on ESSER funds, and they can be chosen in districts, and there was some concern, maybe it was even money chairs, if the, you know, Department of Education was giving guidance because one, there was a potential that some of that money could cover things, it could be clawed back, and others it wasn't. And at least for those of us that weren't on the Education Committee, this I thought made it clear. So I thought as we went forward, it would be helpful for you to get the Finance Committee up to up to the present and what we're looking at.
Sure. First of all, I just want to say I think clawback is an unfortunate term.
It is.
It has bad connotations, and it takes people back to what was a clawback for the healthcare. And this really is not a clawback. This is a reduction.
It's a planting. In education payments.
That's a good word for it, but I try not to use that one. but yes, that's a great word for it. Wow. So again, I missed probably 10, 15 minutes of everything that was going on there. So I'm not sure what was said, what was not said. I came back in when Secretary French was talking about the $100 million. And part of that confusion probably out with the field is probably part of my fault, because I have been talking to people saying my understanding is there has been this money set aside in reserve. Apparently it's not in terms of the governor's budget. So that's probably on me a little bit to the confusion in the field, because I have been talking about that I believe that money was there to backfill if they did not have enough in that $50 million that was allocated that got of CRF funds plus the ESSER money. So anyway, what Secretary French and Bill both said was that we are trying to get folks to use the CRF money first. If a cost can be covered by both ESSER funds and CRF funds, we are trying to direct the school districts to use the CRF funds first for two reasons. One, the CRF money is more short-lived. It ends as of December 30th. ESSER funds continue on for the year, and two-thirds, I guess. And secondly, because the ESSER funds are more, they have a wider use. The uses delineated by the federal folks are much broader than are the CRF. So if one cost can be covered by CRF and ESSER, we are trying to get them to use the CRF, because that will allow the ESSER money to be used for other things because it has a wider series of uses. At this point, and again, this is where I don't know what was said. At this point, I did check with folks who are collecting the ESSER applications from school districts. We've only had two ESSER applications come in. I heard Secretary French saying this has been a slower process than we had hoped. It truly is. We have now gotten two ESSER applications in for about $485,000 in total. I cannot tell at the moment how much of that money was replacing money that was budgeted, which would help the ed fund, versus what was unbudgeted. That, I know that's part of the thing that we need to tease out, because I know that's one of your major concerns, is helping the ed fund. Secondly, in terms of the CRF money, those applications just went out, I believe it was on Friday. And so we will be getting those applications back in about a week. I think we had it's a fast turnaround. I think we're asking to get the information back to us on September 2nd. So I would say probably within another week, call it September 10th, thereabouts, we should probably have some idea of what the CRF money request is going to be, what people are asking for, what's going to be happening. As of right now, I can't put any parameters around those numbers. I have been talking to business managers at the annual meetings at various times. They're aware of what I'm telling you right now, because it's the same thing that I say to them. So that's kind of how we're looking at things being paid for. CRF if possible first, then fill in with ESSER. And then after December 30th, it will be all ESSER money after that. So the idea is to make sure you have enough ESSER money to go. The business managers as a group understand that there's a hole in the education fund. It's getting better, but there's a hole in the education fund. It's a problem. If it's not addressed, it will roll over in FY22, and that will cause them problems also. They also understand that they have costs that are not in their budgets that need to be covered too. So it's a balancing act on both sides, on your side, on their side, and on our side, trying to get folks to use these monies as best they can. What would you like me to do in terms of discussing ESSER or CRF, Madam Chair? I'll happily go either way. I just wanted to kind of get that.
Well, there were two options within ESSER that schools could use, and I thought that's what I got totally confused on. I thought you helped understand that.
Okay. The language in the CARES Act that allowed the ESSER funds to be used says that a portion of ESSER funds will be sent or will be used by the LEAs, in our case, the supervisory unions, will be used by the LEAs for equitable services for kids in independent schools. And what the language said was, it was said, allotted out the same way it's done basically for Title I. Okay, and that's based on poverty counts. So the way equitable services are the way they calculate that proportionate share of money for equitable services is they look at the total number of kids who have meet the poverty criteria in independent schools that want to partake, plus the public schools, and they calculate a percentage based on that, and that's how the money goes out. When U.S. Education came out with their guidance back in, I don't even remember when it was, when they came out with their guidance, instead of basing the proportionate share on poverty counts, they said that they wanted to base it on enrollments instead. So they, if an independent school wanted to partake of equitable services, then it was based on enrollments as opposed to poverty counts. Generally speaking, there's a, if you use enrollments, that's a higher percentage of the total enrollments in an SU versus poverty from independent schools is the total of poverty in an SU. So what that effectively would do would drive more money to the private schools for equitable services and less being available for the public schools. Having said that, one thing to make sure is the money itself does not go to the independent schools. It's the services that money pays for that goes to the independent schools. So it's the supervisory units control the money the whole time. So that was the controversy between basing the equitable services on enrollment and between basing them on poverty count the way the language intimated. There were lawsuits put out, and just recently there was an injunction in Washington State, a preliminary injunction that stopped U.S. Ed from making any LEA across the nation allocate their proportional share on enrollments. Right now, they currently have to do it on poverty. There are other lawsuits that will probably could be. You know, where the judge will make a ruling too. It's anticipated it'll be the same thing. I don't know. It's up in the air. But that's what the controversy was. It was whether this money's going to go out for equitable services based on enrollment, which is a larger piece, or whether it's going to go out based on poverty, which is a smaller piece to the independent schools. That's what the controversy was. And it looks like one court at this time has said no, it's going to be based on poverty, because that's what the CARES Act actually says. The other part of all that is, regardless of which of those two options a school district chooses, it had nothing to do with how much money they got, because that was also a confusion that you folks had that's out there. That was based on a different calculation. The second piece that I think you're asking about, Madam Chair, is if, I'm sorry, after the controversy, before the preliminary injunction, I missed this piece, before the preliminary injunction came out, USED came back out with guidance and said, you may either do equitable services based on enrollment, as they prefer, or you may do it based on poverty. But if you do it based on poverty, then you have to use all of your ESSER funds at only your Title I schools. You can't use them at any of your other schools if you have schools that are Title I and not Title I. So they limited and were trying to get it. They also said that if you choose to use it based on poverty, and not only does it have to be used only at Title I schools, but federal supplement versus supplanting regulations apply. They do not apply if you use enrollment. So, that was the controversy. That's where people were coming in. So now with this preliminary injunction, that whole interpretation of the rule that USED came out with is now on standby, and they're back to the based on poverty without supplementing regulations right now. If there are no supplementing regulations, then that ESSER money can be used for costs within school district budgets that are eligible costs. That then would reduce education fund payments to those school districts, because they have the money from ESSER, so it would be a wash for the school districts. Those monies would not be coming to the education fund, and it would be offsetting helping to offset the deficit down at the bottom. And that was a lot of words, and I apologize. So if there are questions, I'll happily go back over any of it.
Questions for Brad. And I, okay, Senator Perchlick, I believe your committee's getting set to leave, so I'll take your questions first.
Right.
Okay. I think I saw Senator Hardy too, so go for it.
Okay, great. Thank you, Senator Cummings. Yeah, Brad, on the applications that you talked about that have come in, if it's a reimbursement, how are you, can you just talk a little bit how that's working? Are they estimating what they're going to spend and then applying to just so that you can kind of reserve funds for the different schools? How's that working on?
Okay, right now, these are the ESSER ones. And so it's all, this is all money that they've either spent this year, like starting July 1 for fiscal year 21, or that they anticipate spending. They're, so a lot of this is in anticipation of what they're going to do. So they, at this point, I think a lot of school districts have a pretty good idea of what their costs are going to be that they need to have to reopen. So that's what they're putting in their applications.
Brad, is it is fair to say this is the ESSER application. These aren't necessarily reimbursement. This is, the CRF is more of the reimbursement.
Right? Yeah.
So you don't have applications for the CRF
reimbursement? They have not come in yet, no.
But that, will there be applications, or will it just be they just send in their reimbursement?
No, it's basically, we have to run everything through a grant application. They will tell us what they think they're going to need. We will make the grant application itself. And then when they send in their request for the money, they will have to give backup documentation that we can see this is what they spent the money on before we send the money out to them.
Okay. Thanks. Okay.
Senator Hardy, did you have a question?
Yes, thank you, Madam Chair. Well, first, I think it's really important, Brad, that your explanation of the difference between the ESSER funds and the CRF funds and the two ways that the ESSER funds have been interpreted. One of my priorities, and that I've talked to you and others about, is that we try our best to find as an equitable way to distribute funds to school districts. And the ESSER funds, if they are distributed based on poverty, is a much more equitable way of distributing funds than merely a reimbursement situation. So one thing I think I would like us all to keep in mind as we're trying to figure out this puzzle of how the ed fund and school costs and reopening is that if we use the ESSER funds as a way to sort of backfill or save the ed fund, then we're doing it less equitably because then we're not giving funding to the schools that would qualify for the ESSER funds because, and those are the schools, the more students in poverty the schools have, the more ESSER funds they would potentially get. So I think it's just a consideration about equity, or am I interpreting it incorrectly, Brad?
Let me just jump in quickly. There's a set allocation amount for each school, each LEA, each SU, based on the ESSER calculation. The ESSER calculation, the allocation itself was based on Title I monies, how that was spread out between SUs last year, the year that just ended FY20. So everybody got that their percentage. If they got 3% of the Title I money, that's how much ESSER money they got. They got 3% of the ESSER money. It almost sounded a little bit like you were mixing that up with what I was talking about with going with providing money and services to the independent schools based on poverty versus based on enrollment. I just want to be sure that everybody understands that the calculation is, as you said, for how much each SU received for ESSER money was based on the poverty counts based on Title I.
Right. Okay. But still the Title I or poverty counts is a more equitable way of distributing funds than merely a reimbursement situation. So it's just a consideration if how we use the ESSER funds has an equity component to it, and making sure that we're not losing that equity component in terms of how schools are, what money schools are getting. I guess I just want to make that point. And then I do have a question, since our committee is leaving to go to the Ed Committee's leaving. I just wanted to make sure I know a concern of school districts, and I've talked to Secretary French already about this, but is the average daily membership counts for FY for this current school year, mm-hmm. and how they may be affected by the number of families who are choosing to officially homeschool their children. And that would drop the ADM counts and could have a negative effect on school district budgets moving forward. So I know that there's this is on a lot of people's radar, but I just want to advocate for making sure we take care of that during this session, so school districts have an accurate count of their ADM for putting together their FY22 budgets. So potentially holding harmless their ADM counts or using the FY19 or 20 counts instead of penalizing them for this particular situation where a lot of families may be choosing to homeschool temporarily. So I just wanted to say that before we had to leave, even though it hadn't come up yet. And thank you, Senator Cummings, for having the Ed Committee join.
Thank you for joining us. Okay, I think most of the Ed Committee is gone. Are there any other questions for Brad? Everybody understands ESSER, right? Okay. Next one I have is Nathan Lavery. It's been a while, Nathan.
Hi, good afternoon. Yes, it has been a while, but I'm happy to be here. I think just in terms of content, if it pleases the chair, it may make more sense to let Sue Siglowski and Chelsea Myers kind of kick it off for us as a group.
Okay, that's whatever works for you. So Sue, we'll go down to you. Where is Sue?
I am right here. And
there you are.
Chelsea and I are... Chelsea and I are doing a joint presentation. She's actually going to start off and then I will finish it. So if you don't mind, could we start with Chelsea?
Welcome, Chelsea. I don't know if you've been to Senate Finance before.
I haven't. Thank you, Senator Cummings. I'll just quickly introduce myself. I'm Chelsea Myers. I work with Jeff Francis at the Vermont Superintendents Association. I'm the Associate Executive Director. And as Sue said, we're going to present some joint testimony, and then I believe Jay and Nathan will speak more to their memberships and what they're hearing. So on behalf of the Vermont Superintendents Association and the Vermont School Boards Association, we would like to thank you for inviting us to speak to your committee on the current fiscal implications of reopening schools amidst the COVID-19 pandemic. Before I like really dig in, I just wanted to make a comment on the ESSER equitable shares, since it was just being talked about. We have heard from some districts that they will have, if the current ruling stands, they will have to allocate all of their ESSER money to independent schools based on the calculation. So that's something to consider moving forward. So school boards and administrators have been working tirelessly to responsibly navigate the safe reopening of schools on September 8th, as you all know. This includes contending with evolving health and safety guidance, competing concerns from families, staff, and community members, operational and logistical challenges, and the significant academic development and social needs of the students they serve. At this time, we have two key recommendations for your committee to consider to ensure school districts have the financial stability and support to safely reopen schools in September. And we will conclude with a few additional observations. So first, at the end of June, the General Assembly set aside $100 million of coronavirus relief funds to help K-12 schools with the cost of reopening schools during the pandemic and to address a deficit in the education fund if possible. The governor's budget does not include money to help schools deal with reopening costs amid the COVID-19 crisis. If the federal coronavirus relief funds are not used to pay for these unbudgeted costs of reopening schools, districts will be operating in a deficit, which will need to be addressed in the following year's budget, leading to a spike in property taxes and potentially drastic cuts to spending at a time when students will need additional academic, social, and emotional support. VSA has begun to collect information. I will say we started this collection before the CRF application went out on Friday. So some of the information might have been changed based on what school districts have learned since then. But the cost associated, we collected information on the cost associated with reopening schools. We have not heard from a significant portion of them yet, but it is becoming clear that the estimates will likely exceed the original allocation for reimbursement, though more information needs to be collected. Furthermore, many business managers and superintendents have reported uncertainty about what is considered an allowable cost. Given the go-ahead this summer to do what it takes to safely reopen schools in the fall, districts have purchased protective equipment and cleaning supplies, increased their technological capabilities, hired additional staff such as custodians, school nurses, and the highly coveted right now substitute teachers, and committed to providing childcare for their employees while their children are in remote learning. They have not yet been reimbursed for these expenses. Again, this was prior to Friday, and have significant concerns about operating at a deficit leading up to an extraordinarily difficult budget season.
Chelsea, let me interrupt for a minute. Mm-hmm. Were these expenses they were hoping to have covered with the CRF funds or?
So what we asked them to do is to report to us if they could, as you can imagine, people are quite busy right now, what they have spent and what they are anticipating spending. And as I said, we haven't really had a clear total collection of that information, so I don't feel comfortable sharing it at this time. But what we are finding from our preliminary investigations is that it will likely exceed the original reimbursement amount.
Is that the estimate that Secretary French talked about based on national models of?
No, so this is actually specifically asking the superintendents to report what they've spent and what they anticipate.
Okay, all right.
Yeah. So as a secondary factor, in many cases, it is unclear to the field how to be proactive and supportive of the efforts to use federal funds to address the education funds shortfall. And from the conversations I've had with superintendents and business managers, this is, while not the first priority, as that's the safe reopening of schools, that they are concerned moving forward with the education fund. We respectfully request that the General Assembly proceed with its original plan for the $100 million, which were set aside for K through 12 education. We understand that that may not have been the original plan from the administration's perspective. The Agency of Education and the administration have strongly encouraged school leaders to procure the equipment and hire the personnel needed to reopen safely, with the understanding that coronavirus relief funds would be available to reimburse districts for the associated costs. A change in course requiring local taxpayers to pick up the cost could disrupt reopening plans already in place. In particular, more systems may determine that if they don't have the proper funds to move forward in the safest manner possible, that they may move to remote learning, which would, of course, have additional implications for the reopening of Vermont's economy. With that, I'm going to pass it over to Sue Siglowski, who will finish us up the testimony.
Okay. Then we're going to Sue.
Thank Any you, Chelsea, questions at this point?
I'm not seeing any questions. All right. So Sue will go to up. Oh, Senator Ballant has a question.
Just Chelsea, you alluded to this quickly, and I know it's this is finance and not general ed committee, but have you been hearing from school boards that there is going to be a shortage of substitute teachers? Is this something that school boards are reporting to you?
Yeah, I mean, we have heard that substitute teachers, and to be honest, substitute teachers are always a hot commodity, but even more so now when we have uncertainty about illness and leave. So a lot of, I shouldn't say a lot, I've heard from several superintendents that they are hiring permanent subs to make sure that they have someone available for that purpose.
And do you know if any of those school districts are having to increase the pay to entice people to do the job?
I don't have the answer to that.
Okay. Something to watch. Any other questions? Okay. Sue, it is your floor.
Thank you. There's one thing I can add to answer Senator Ballant's question about substitutes. There are some superintendents that are into requesting waivers from the Agency of Education in order to allow school board members to serve as substitutes in the districts where they serve as school board members. That's not allowed under the statute unless you get a waiver. And so there are some places that are actually looking for those waivers. Moving back into our presentation, the second concern that we wanted to cover is something that was mentioned by Senator Hardy before she left. It has to do with a concern about reductions in equalized pupil counts for the fiscal year 2022, which are attributable to declines in enrollment in the current school year, resulting from decisions by families either to homeschool or enroll students in private schools or other factors that will lead to decreased enrollment during this time period. The Vermont Superintendents Association did a survey earlier this month that indicates with 46 superintendents responding, 85% are either very concerned or concerned about declines in enrollment in the current year due to COVID-19 dynamics. This concern is shared by other local school officials. As you and other legislators are keenly aware, a decline in equalized pupils will translate to an increase in education spending per equalized pupil and increased tax rates at the very time when schools need to both invest in learning opportunities for students and when they are contending with the economic effects of the COVID-19 crisis. The importance of the General Assembly taking action on this issue in August stems from the fact that school districts will receive equalized pupil counts in December to inform FY 2022 budget deliberations and preparation. By December 15th, budget development work is nearing completion for school boards with budgets slated for finalization in January so that they can be warned and presented to voters in March. This year, more than ever, districts need a stable environment for their budget development process, and a decrease in equalized pupils resulting from COVID-19 effects would be tremendously destabilizing. So our associations are recommending that 16 VSA Section 4010 be amended to establish a one-year hold harmless protection against declines in equalized pupils in order to stabilize budget development for FY 2022. And we have four additional observations. The first one is that in an August 5th letter to the House and Senate Education Committees, the superintendents serving Vermont's three technical center school districts informed legislators that they had learned from the Vermont Agency of Education that under current law, their districts are not eligible for federal COVID-19 relief funds. It was later announced that the entirety of the governor's emergency education relief fund, the GEAR fund, which is $4 million, would be directed to the career and technical education. Our associations believe strongly that technical center school districts should be granted sufficient funding for the reopening of schools through one of the available federal funding sources. Second, our associations have heard concerns from members that receive revenue through tuition dollars paid by so-called choice districts in Vermont. We have not yet surveyed receiving districts about this concern, but we are hearing from school officials about anticipated revenue shortfalls in districts accustomed to receiving tuition revenues, where those revenues are expected to decrease due to COVID-19 related enrollment decisions. To the extent that anticipated revenues do decline, operating deficits will likely occur in those districts. It may not be necessary for the General Assembly to consider this issue in the August session, but it is a situation that may require to be addressed in January. Third, in June, the legislature created a $6.5 million school indoor air quality grant program. That's the HVAC program that you've been talking about previously today. And this was to help schools repair and upgrade their heating, ventilation, and air conditioning systems to meet the COVID-19 specific guidelines from the U.S. Centers for Disease Control and Prevention. It has been reported that approximately 300 schools are interested in applying for the grant, and that project prices vary, with many in the $40,000 to $60,000 per school range. At a $40,000 per project, 300 schools would need $12 million, and at $60,000 per project, 300 schools would need $18 million. And we're bringing this to your attention because ventilation and air filtration are a major concern when considering whether or not to reopen a school for in-person instruction. And current information indicates that more funds are going to be needed to allow schools to meet the CDC guidelines. If you'd like more information, we refer you to pages 24 and 25 of the Strong and Healthy START Safety and Health Guidance for Reopening Schools, which was issued jointly by the Vermont Agency of Education and Department of Health. And we'll send you in some written testimony with a link to that. And finally, in February, there were two bills that were drafted that would have provided breakfast and lunch free of charge for all students. And as a result, back then, the JFO provided the estimated cost of universal free breakfast and lunch based on the 2018-2019 free and reduced lunch enrollment for 175 school days. And that information was $40,656,000 with current participation in free and reduced price lunch program, and roughly $50,820,000 with potential loss of federal aid. And we just point out these estimates because they provide essential information that will be needed if it's the intention of the General Assembly and the Governor to continue to provide universal free breakfast and lunch to all students during the COVID-19 crisis. And that concludes our presentation. Thank you.
I think I froze.
No. Okay. I think, sorry, turn to Campion. Yeah.
Thanks. So I'm just wondering about the free lunches. So that go right now, it goes until when, the end of August?
The summer meals?
Yes.
Allocation? Is that what you're referring to? 12 million? I believe so, yes. Nathan will be speaking next. Nathan Lavery, the business manager, he may have some more information about.
It is kind of challenging to see how we're going to do free breakfast and lunch for all the schools where the kids are only in school 2 days, which means if we're going to do it, we'll have to deliver it, right? We've been doing that this summer, at least to some extent. But that's not up a dirt road in a blizzard in January. So, okay. All right. Issues. Okay. Sue, have you finished? We kind of cut you off there.
Yes, I'm finished. Thank you.
Okay. Any other questions?
Yeah.
Turn to Pearson.
Madam Chair, I don't know if this is a fair question for Sue or the secretary or whomever, but as I listen, and we've been thinking about the intense costs and need for to get reopened and to deal with all sorts of things like shortage of substitutes, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. We have and I know I can appreciate that we've been very guarded around talking about the idea of schools not being open, or having another stay-at-home order. But it strikes me that we will likely get very ready and figure out how to come up with budgets and invest significant resources to make this succeed. And then there is some chance, we have to acknowledge at least some chance, that by October or November, we are in fact retreating and working entirely remotely. And I'm wondering if there's at least some planning somewhere that would allow the state to kind of not necessarily have to spend all the money or recoup some of the money if we're not going to be in person. Just some of that thinking. I wouldn't want anyone watching to get the idea that any of us think it's important that we're remote, you know, I think the hybrid is what it is and likely reasonable, but I just wonder if there is some contingency there that might actually help us save some resources.
Is that one you can answer? Is there any planning or just what happens if we do get shut down again? Do we and need to go to all remote? Are we ready to do that? Do we have a contingency plan, or are we just so focused on getting open in 2 weeks that we're everyone wants to answer this question. So I saw you unmuted, so it's you.
Okay, well, I can start and just let you know that there are a few districts that are actually starting in remote. So that they are doing remote education right from the beginning. And I believe that districts that are going with the hybrid method are they have planning in place in case they need to move to remote. I don't know how closely they are, how much they're thinking about how that affects the cost. I think that they're trying to do what is best for their community and their students. But there may be others on the line that have more information about the remote.
Okay. Chelsea, I see you're unmuted. Do you have anything to add?
Yeah, just to add to Sue's, we collected fairly detailed information from all of the superintendents about 2 weeks ago. That information shows up in VT Digger in a recent article. But a lot of the schools have also planned, if they're doing hybrid learning, have planned and are offering a fully remote academy, a lot of them are calling it. So in terms of being ready from an academic and support level, they are mostly all ready for that.
Okay. All right. Any other questions at this point? If not, I'm gonna go to Nathan.
Great, well, thanks again. It's nice to be here, and I appreciate the opportunity to share some of the perspective of the Vermont Association of School Business Officials, which are your business managers, your financial people in school districts across the state. For those who don't know me, I'm also the business manager in the Burlington School District. So I can speak to a degree about, kind of anecdotally, about what we are doing in Burlington, if it becomes relevant. I think the main point that I want to reiterate today is that schools have been told in various ways virtually since school closed this past spring that federal funds would be available and are intended to make schools whole for the cost of reopening safely. And no alternative guidance has been communicated that would give us any reason to believe that we should be doing anything other than ensuring that we have the tools and the systems in place to open safely for our students and our staff. And it certainly has not been suggested that we need to sacrifice that due to a lack of available funding. And that message has been clear from various channels, but including from the Agency of Education. So we're glad that they share that. I think Dan reiterated that during his testimony this afternoon. And what seems like it is changing in terms of the message is whether or not the costs will be completely reimbursed as we were led to believe. And I think that is really the key here. I don't think there's anyone who doubts the fact that it's going to be a challenging budget development year this fall. And I think that it would be extremely complicating to really the next few years to put school districts in a position where they don't get fully reimbursed for their costs and are instead asking their local taxpayers to foot the bill when there's actually federal money that is available and that the legislature intended to go to cover the cost for schools. So I think that couldn't be clearer to business managers across the state that that's the expectation, and we've been operating under that guidance for months at this point. The other issues that were brought up with respect to ADM and the independent tech centers getting funding. I'm glad to hear, particularly on that front, that there is an opportunity there to use the Governor Emergency Relief Fund. Those are also things that business managers believe do need attention. And so we're glad to hear those as well. But again, I feel like I'm here primarily today to talk about the importance of ensuring that there's adequate reimbursement available for schools. One of the encouraging things, although it's a lot of work for schools, is that the deadline for our application for CRF funds, while it doesn't guarantee the exact amount, we are being asked to estimate our need for those funds through the end of December. So at that point, and that's due September 2nd, at that point, the agency should have the information it needs to be able to say with a reasonable degree of confidence what schools actually think that they will spend through the end of December. We all know that there's a lot of uncertainty in this process. The health situation could change, the guidance could change, the science could change. There's a lot of uncertainty, but that's going to be probably the best and most comprehensive data that we have in terms of trying to figure out, is 50 million enough? Is 100 million enough? We should at least have some sense. Probably, I would think an order of magnitude at that time. We may not know exactly, and I would certainly advise that whatever number is indicated, that we leave ourselves a margin for error there to reflect the uncertainty. But it certainly seems at that point, we would be in a position to potentially back away from the full commitment. But at this point, I don't believe we're in that position. And I think that that would be very concerning to school business officials and potentially taxpayers across the state if it turns out that they're being asked to foot the bill for expenses that that we believe the federal government intended to have covered for us. So I think that's where I see an opportunity and a benefit to the data that is going to be collected over the next couple weeks. And I would hope that in the meantime, we don't make any decisions that put us in a position of potentially jeopardizing full reimbursements to schools, because the reality is I don't think there's any more compelling case to be made for supporting school spending than the health and safety of the children in our state.
Okay. Any questions for Nathan? Not seeing any. Okay, thank you. Jane Nichols is next.
Good afternoon. For the record, I'm Jay Nichols, Executive Director of the Vermont Principals Association. And I want to close our testimony by saying that the testimony that Sue and Chelsea shared with you is collectively supported by the Vermont School Boards Association, the Vermont Superintendents Association, the Vermont Principals Association, the Vermont School Business Managers Association, as well as the Vermont Council of Special Educators. So that's joint. We all support those same major goals that Sue and Chelsea articulated. I thought my testimony related to education and finances would be most illustrative if I shared some of the things that schools have had expenses for as a direct result of COVID-19 and working to ensure a safe reopening of school. Our schools are expecting to have sufficient funds with the 100 million we were told in June we would have. We've been telling school leaders to spend what they need to spend to make sure they can reopen schools safely. And we've been asked by the governor and the AOE to do that. If this costs less than $100 million, we hope the remainder can be used to close the gap in the Ed Fund. We do realize this will be up to the US Congress in some respects. So here are just some of the things that principals have shared in the last week of what they're spending money on. Schools have purchased tents. Many have constructed outdoor classroom solutions or expanding existing outdoor infrastructure, such as adding picnic tables, carports, and other areas to make outdoor classrooms. Schools have hired additional staff to work as screeners, both on buses and at school, additional custodial staff to help with buildings being cleaned and disinfecting, various decision points around meals for places that won't be able to use their cafeteria, and working with bus companies to deliver meals to families in remote settings, buying masks, sanitizer, extra cleaning and disinfectant products, hiring of permanent subs to staff the building. One district told me today they've hired 9 permanent subs in their district because they know that they will need them between their 6 schools. Increasing of nursing time. Many schools do not have a nurse, and schools are looking at finding ways to make sure they have more nursing time in place. Taking on additional mental health support contracts to better support our neediest students. And I'm afraid this one's going to be a tremendous cost overall, and it won't be a quick financial fix. This is going to be something we're going to be struggling with for the next few years, I'm sure. Buying plexiglass dividers, repurposing rooms to create social distancing, computers for kids, prepaid internet cards, remote hotspots for families to improve connectivity for students that don't have it. You've heard about HVAC upgrades, and as was mentioned earlier, one school system is even pushing back their in-person learning. They were going to start on September 8th with some degree of in-person learning. They're now looking at closer to Thanksgiving before having the kids back. There's districts that are buying Zoom cameras and microphones to the classroom so that people remote can hear in the classroom and vice versa. Portable air humidifiers for classrooms is a real big expense that a lot of schools are buying into. CO2 monitors. Some schools are actually taking rooms and creating isolation rooms. So if they have kids that come down with exposure, they have to isolate them. They don't have a place to do that right now. They're building rooms to do that within other rooms or other spaces in their buildings. This is causing costs for plumbing, purifiers, and in some cases, paraeducator support to help cover this extra nurse's office, for lack of a better word. They're also creating standalone self-contained sinks in some of these creation rooms because we need running water and stuff in those situations. Buying extra sessions of the Vermont Virtual Learning Consortium so that they can provide more access to students that are learning in a remote environment, and extra summer hours. And those are just a few things that money's being spent on. In addition, just a couple extra thoughts. Schools are completely rethinking their master schedules, student and staff migration during the school day, as well as planning for the ability to move between in-person and remote options as conditions dictate, as was asked in a question earlier. Schools are planning for, if we're coming back remote, how soon can we get to in-person instruction and what will that look like? If we're coming back to in-person instruction, what will we do if the conditions require us to go into a hybrid or fully remote, and being prepared for that as much as they can? There are major concerns, as committee members have mentioned, about staffing at our schools. Will they actually be able to keep the school running if a couple of staff members get sick, or if staff can't go to work because they have to take care of their own children? Lots of concern about finding substitutes. What to do about music classes is a big issue that we've talked about a lot in the last couple weeks, especially when it becomes too hard to go outside because of the weather. We know that singing is one of the biggest transmitters of this disease. And so if we have kids singing, they need to be outside 6 feet apart, maybe still with mask on, singing all in the same direction. That's hard to do in January in Vermont. We're worried about delivery of special education services. Those were incredibly difficult in the spring, and I don't think we were all that successful. And I don't think it's gonna be a lot better if we're in a remote environment this fall. And lots of worry about different districts doing different things and a problem that causes for staff who have children of their own in a different school, and for parents that are able to go to work full-time in some systems, but forced to perhaps stay home in others because one system decides to go full in-person learning while the system next door might decide to go fully remote. I also want to mention that we, the VPA, with support from philanthropic groups and with selected support from VSA members, that Chelsea actually served on our committee, we've given out almost $200,000 to support schools with urgent needs. And we could have easily given out 100 times that. And I'm not exaggerating. We've got hundreds of requests for things, everything from extra money for picnic tables to social emotional supports, outdoor learning environments. I could show you the list. It's amazing the applications that we've received. And we've given out our money in $3,000 to $5,000 grants, and we could give out a lot more. And lastly, although there are significant costs of reopening, the hope is to be in a position where students can get back to in-person learning as soon as possible. There are costs associated with this that are not associated with remote learning. But we know, and the evidence clearly demonstrates, that remote learning pales in comparison to in-person instruction. This is especially true for our most vulnerable students. They need to be in school, in person, receiving that instruction. I also want to mention, and Nathan touched on this, that I'm very worried about future financial aspects of this pandemic, and the FY22 budget is of extreme concern as well for our public education system and our economy overall. So it's my hope that we can close the education gap, if possible, without using education fund reserves, as it is very likely we might need those next year. So I'm hoping that we'll be really careful about putting things onto the education fund, such as the community prison education system, and asking schools to pay for other things that really should not be asked of schools during this time. And subject to questions, that's all I have. Thank you.
Okay, committee. not seeing any. I think the message I'm getting is don't spend that $100 million on something else until we're absolutely certain we don't need it. We have an issue with enrollment and what happens if parents who are concerned decide to go homeschool. And then a vaccine pops up in the second half of the year, those kids are back in school with no funding behind them. We have an issue with the tech centers, which that's one I hadn't heard about. And I'll let the ed department, the ed committee worry about tuition students. But has anyone heard, there's been all kinds of rumors about people who moved here who were enrolling there, they came to stay for the pandemic in their second homes. They are supposedly enrolling their kids in mass numbers. Are we seeing schools that are seeing significant upticks in enrollments this year? Do we know that yet?
We have some, well, Brad can probably give you the numbers. We have some.
Brad has numbers.
Yeah, numbers, Brad?
No.
We have some towns that have indicated to us through their principal that they have increased enrollment. A lot of these are, I don't want to use the word ski towns, but some of our towns that tend to attract tourists.
Our second homes are more abundant.
Thank you. That was much, much more politically correct, Senator Cummings. I appreciate that. So we have seen some of that. We've also seen places that are worried about having less students as well. So we don't really know how this is going to sugar out. And typically, when there's an influx of students, they tend to be in communities that are in better shape financially than our most vulnerable and challenged towns.
We've also heard from a superintendent that reported that more state-placed students are being placed in those districts that are opening more in person than remote. So those that are fully in person or 4 days in person. So that might be something to flag as well.
Might be where some of the migration is coming from. Okay. All right. Any other questions? If not, we've got Jeff Fannin. And then we'll go on to who gets to come to these meetings. Okay, Jeff, the floor is yours.
Good afternoon, Senate Finance. Jeff Fannin from Vermont and EA for the record. And I guess I stand between you and a break. So I'll try to.
No, there's no break coming.
Okay. So the six or seven management groups came together and laid out a pretty good list. And I my written testimony, which I think you now have maybe in front of you, echoes much of it. But we didn't rehearse this together at all. But it's largely the three issues, I think, in some sense of the word, that they talked about, or at least we want to talk about. And prefaced with the fact that schools are working as never before and have since the closure in March to address every kid's need. And they are becoming painfully aware. We're well aware now that schools are the hub of most of their communities. They're serving kids lunch, breakfast, and whether they were in remote in the fall or they're gonna return to school in the spring or coming back in the fall here. So some are doing a hybrid plan and they're trying to figure out how to feed kids on days they're not in school. So they're trying to do, so the added expense of just feeding kids alone is not insignificant, right? You've got a cohort of kids coming in a hybrid model, for example, A through M or whatever that school's doing. You're feeding those kids in school and then the rest of the kids you're feeding outside of school. So you're running, you know, two trains at the same time, and the costs are significantly more just to feed kids. I think the 12.5 million for summer food money and only 2.2, I think it was, being requested had to do with the delay. And I think delay in getting that information out there, and either more of that information is going to come back, or a lot of people just didn't provide summer lunches this summer, which is unfortunate. So we are moving very quickly, all by way of saying we are moving very quickly. Schools are doing a magnificent job, and some are doing certainly significantly better than others, and it varies. But they're all trying their best, and there's a lot of challenges with in-person return in the fall, remote entirely in the fall, which now I think three or four districts are up to, are doing all remote or hybrid, which a lot are doing. So everything presents a little bit differently, and schools are challenged with everyone in different and unique ways. So Chelsea, Nathan, and Jay all mentioned the $100 million, what I call the fenced off money. I think somebody referred to it as well in that regard. The budget, the first quarter budget that you passed in June and the governor signed into law, certainly, if not explicitly, did incorporate that type of thinking into the budget. And I think it's important that we hold true to that. And so while the governor's proposed budget does not include that yet, I'm hopeful that we can all figure out a way to make sure that schools do receive the money that they've been told they would receive since March. As Nathan pointed out, they've planned accordingly and counted on that and in reliance on that money. And that, as kids are just about to return in many cases, they need to be, the schools need to be, that deal, if you will, needs to be held true. And Sue mentioned the ADM issue. Again, I mentioned that here in my memo. The ADM is the fluctuations in enrollment. You're right, some schools have seen an uptick, but mostly schools are seeing a downward decline in enrollment. Homeschool applications were up 75% last I knew from the AOE. So a lot of parents are holding their kids back, educating them at home as best they can. And schools should not be harmed by that change, because it's a temporary blip, I think. I think we'll all agree it's because of the pandemic that they're suffering these but the fluctuations as never before. So they ought to be held harmless for those fluctuations, at least this year, certainly. And while not a finance issue per se, the number of school days you may see coming across your transom at some point down the road. Right now, current law says that kids have to be in school at least 175 days. And we think that needs to be relaxed a bit this year because of all the fluctuations that we're going to see. We think that there, I think somebody was talking about contingency plans about remote education. Certainly, we think as the cold and flu season starts in earnest in November, we may see blooms in the virus itself, and schools will need to shut down. And so the 175-day requirement may be, I think schools will need some flexibility and some relaxation of that rule. So you'll see that probably come across your desk as well. So those are the three things that we have to say. Schools are doing great work trying to reopen in whatever form they've thought to do so. I think the $100 million is a huge issue currently and going forward. The ADM is something as well currently and going forward as the enrollment counts are coming in, and certainly the 175-day calendar issue. So those are my issues. People are nervous and anxious about returning. There's a lot of anxiety out in the field. We're hearing a lot of it, but I think a lot of people, some people are ready and really want to get back into school in whatever form their district is doing it, remotely or hybrid or in person entirely. So I think people are excited about the fall, and kids need to be get their education back on track. It's not going to look like it normally would be. Even if they're in school, I hesitate to say this, but it's true. Even if schools are all in person, it's not going to look like it did a year ago. Schools are going to look very different this year. They're going to act very differently in how they deliver education because of the spacing requirements, the mask requirements. It's going to be a far different education experience, but it will be hopefully up to standards to educate our kids. They deserve it, and we count on it. So I'm happy to answer any questions.
Okay, any questions for Jeff? Not seeing any. This, I would say, is pleasant to see that everybody seems to be going in the same direction and delivering basically the same message, and it's encouraging.
We did not rehearse that, I promise you. Management may have, but labor did not.
It says we are all doing our best to make sure that the students and the staff are able to go back to school with as much safety as it is possible to give them. And we know that at least the next 3 to 6 months are highly fluid and perhaps volatile, and we're prepared to make the change. And I think we did it. We did it without any prep last March, and did an excellent job. So hopefully we will keep doing that. And I'm open to any other questions or comments. If not, committee, I can give you a 5-minute break, but our next presenters are here, and it's really just a committee discussion on how do we deal with people who want to be on the Zoom meeting but are not witnesses. I all got a copy of letters signed by a lot of groups saying that they would like more access. Leadership said, well, it's up to you guys, you know, each committee. So I thought we would have a discussion in the committee about how we wanted to deal with this. So I think we're finished with Ed.
Thank you all.
Thank you all. And I'm glad that Senator Pearson is with us, since he's probably our most tech savvy person. But I'd asked to have Kevin Moore kind of be with us to tell us what our options are. And I see that Mike Ferrant and Peggy of all Delaney have shown up. But this is really my one request. Anyone that wants to testify, I will let testify. You know, and if they drop me an email or if they drop Faith an email, we can do it. The one thing I would find difficult is if I suddenly got 57 chat messages and I'm trying to monitor a witness, the committee who wants to talk and read messages. I mean, one I can handle, but if there were a whole lot, it would be challenging, but it can be done. So, okay, I've got Senator Pearson, then Senator Brock. That's the order I saw the hands.
Madam Chair, I wonder if we should just, you know, the time where it could help us is when we have questions that we're not getting an answer to and people watching potentially have the answer. And I wonder if Faith is always with us, and I wonder if we couldn't ask people if they have something to add to email Faith. Faith jumps in and says, do you guys want to hear from so-and-so, and you or the committee makes a decision. That I don't see another really workable answer, but anyway, just off the top of my head.
I don't either. And I think Faith, you can join this meeting since your name is being used. As long as you're only monitoring us, that might work. I know on occasion you have been doing at least two committees at once, it might get a little challenging, but if we can keep it to when you're just doing one committee, can that work for you? Okay.
It would be fine.
Okay. So we could just tell anyone that feels they have something to add to email Faith. Then I assume we could let them into the meeting, or you could chat the comment up to us. We could probably let them into the meeting unless we were booked through till 5 o'clock at night. Which point I'd put them on the next day anyway. So, Senator Brock, did you have?
I did. I just had really a couple of issues and questions. When we hold a normal in-person meeting,
everybody who's sitting in the audience is not at the table, nor can they speak or ask questions, as just as a normal course of business. It's no different than being on YouTube. On the other hand, if a person wants to testify, the invitation, such as the one that you gave, Madam Chair, applies to in-person meetings just as it does to online meetings. So there is an opportunity to testify. I'm concerned a little bit from a technological standpoint, and perhaps the IT folks can guide us here. But if we allow people in and we're using a recurring meeting number and presumably a recurring password, does that expose the future to those same people constantly being on? Now, I realize that we let people in or out of meeting, but I'm just a little bit concerned about how we do this technically to provide at least a degree of security for access to the meetings. By access, I mean the ability to participate and play porn and do other kinds of things on our meeting site, as opposed to the ability that we give people with YouTube, for example, to see everything that's going on. And so that's a technical question that I have concerning it.
Okay, and I think, lost my train of thought. The one difference I can see is that if there's an interest group sitting in the room and they stick their hand up and, you know, I can recognize them and we add them as a witness on the agenda. If we've got time, if we don't, we put them on before, you know, the next day. We can still do the next day. The immediate input is not there. On the other hand, it's much easier for people to watch us, just the general public, if they are so bored. They don't have to come down to Montpelier. They can just click on YouTube and watch us do whatever we're doing. So for some people, this is easier access if you have broadband. Another subject dear to our hearts. But so Kevin, you're here. What can we do? What are our options?
I thank you for recognizing me, Madam Chair. I did see Senator Ballant's hand up first. I don't want to cut her off if she had a thought.
Oh, Kevin, you go ahead. I'll save it for the end.
All right. For the record, my name is Kevin Moore. I'm the Director of IT for the General Assembly. I appreciate the invitation today to discuss this a little bit. I would state just at face value at the start of it, our recommendations don't change at this point on how to host these meetings. We certainly understand that the virtual world does not live up to the physical world that we were used to in March. There are some things that are lacking. If there is something pressing enough that you would want to have the general public attend these virtual meetings, we would be required to change this platform a little bit, which would require a heavy staff presence from the committee assistance and operations unit. I don't want to speak in detail on that particular part. I'll leave that for Peggy Delaney or Mike Ferrant, as they're the ones who actually have done that work. Again, our recommendations aren't changing at this point. We do understand that there is some deficiencies, if you will, in the virtual platform in comparison to the physical world. And we're happy to try to match technology to desire, depending on what your committee is looking to do.
So if there's going to be a change, it would be best if any or all, that it was the same change with any committee. Now, if we're going to do something, everybody should essentially do the same thing if it's going to require you alter the platform.
So consistency is certainly a benefit. We are a small organization in the grand scheme of things. We're a small IT staff. You have a small committee services team. You have a small operations team. It's incredibly challenging to get these meetings off the ground and make sure that it's coordinated effectively. So if there is consistency, we would greatly value that. We would greatly appreciate that. Understanding that Senator Ash has left it up to individual committees' decisions at this point, we will certainly honor that as well.
So would it, if we did what we had discussed and just say anyone that had something to add or wanted to talk could email the committee staff, and if it was just a comment, she could chat us or just let us know that somebody wanted to talk tomorrow on that issue. That wouldn't require a change, would it?
It wouldn't. That's something that you could work into your existing workflow as appropriate. We wouldn't have to change anything technically. And I again would defer the capacity question to Faith and the committee services group at that point.
Okay. Yeah, chat is beyond my pay grade. So I'm not, I know at one point we got a message that anything we chatted between ourselves was going out over YouTube. So the comments on people's haircuts or backgrounds or whatever ceased. But if, is it possible to open chat or?
So at the committee level, Madam Chair, you are able to use that chat function that is not broadcast out towards YouTube at the committee level. At your Senate chamber level, we use a different platform to stream.
Okay, it was the Senate chamber.
Yes.
Okay, no note passing. But we could, can outsiders chat without being in?
In the Zoom meeting, no. Could they use the existing chat features and comment features that are on the YouTube platform? Absolutely. The YouTube platform is about 15 to 25 seconds delayed, depending on the day. However, you could monitor that if that was a choice of the committee. And again, within the capacity of the committee assistants, you could monitor that chat. It's not regulated. It's not something we have real control over on that chat function other than turning it on or off as appropriate, as deemed appropriate by the committee. But that function does exist if somebody wanted to just jump on YouTube and chat. If your committee was actively monitoring that chat function, you could use that. Alternatively, also, email would be a wonderful record as well.
See where that might get a little, that has the potential for getting a little overwhelming in that, is there any limit to how many words you can put in a chat?
I don't have that information in front of me at this point. It is unrestricted as far as access goes, and it could allow either internet bots or internet trolls to comment. That does happen from time to time as it is.
I wasn't even thinking about bots or trolls.
There are some unsavory folks out there who spend their time trying to interfere, regardless of
platform. I was just thinking of people who have very strong opinions that write us emails that might, you know, that you can then choose your time to answer them, might to send that comment to the committee staff, which could get a little overwhelming. We need her to keep us in line.
It certainly could. As a potential alternative, if you're looking for a place to funnel information aside from the committee assistant, we could create another email account for your committee or for a topic and funnel it appropriately. There are a couple different ways we could approach that if that's a concern. I do think email is a better method than using the YouTube chat function. It allows you to really triage things rather than trying to keep up with what you've actually read or not read in that chat window.
I'm just thinking about having to have a third or fourth screen.
Yes. Well, I'm sitting on.
I got my agenda. I got my documents, and now I got to have my emails.
I can certainly appreciate that. But I do want to leave some time for Peggy and Mike to weigh in on from their perspective as well.
Okay, Peggy.
Hi, Peggy Delaney. Oh, sorry. Peggy Delaney, Committee Services Supervisor. I think my concern, I think it sounds great, Senator Cummings, to say on a YouTube meeting, if anyone has a comment, email Faith. But I think, you know, behind the scenes, I think sometimes people don't realize how challenging these Zoom meetings can be. In some ways they're easier, in some ways they're harder. And when you're on I know myself, because I do Senate Judiciary, And when you're on a committee meeting and you're trying to share screen and you're reading emails and you're reading chats and you're getting texts and you're trying to listen to the chair, it can be a lot. And there are times that you don't even get an opportunity to go to your email for a while. And my fear is if it's one or two people, I've gotten emails from people that I know. John Campbell emails me, I'm listening, Peggy, can I jump in? I know John Campbell, I know it's okay to let him in, no problem. But if you're in a situation where you throw a comment out, like if anybody has comments, email Faith, who knows how many people you're gonna get, who knows if you're gonna know who those people are. I certainly wouldn't wanna enter anybody into a Zoom meeting unless I knew who they were. If you don't know who they were, then she's gonna have to reach out to you or interrupt the meeting or whatever. I just think it could be disruptive and it could take away from the focus on the committee meeting themselves. I think people do have the opportunity to email ahead of time. They know when these meetings are taking place. If it's an advocate, a lobbyist, they can email Faith or you ahead of time and say, I'd like to be at the meeting. Agendas are posted the weekend before. If they want to testify, they can email and you can say yay or nay at that time. I just think it again, if it's a one or two person and you know them, that's easy. But if it becomes a lot more and we don't know who the people are and then we let some in, but then you don't see others, then we'll be accused of letting certain people in and not others. So I do have some real concerns about it, to be honest.
Okay. And I actually need the committee chair or the staff to be able to pay attention to what's going on.
Yeah.
Because I've got three screens and sometimes I miss something like names. Yeah. So it's very helpful when you do agenda planning to have a staff person that's actually got the freedom to listen to the testimony, and then, you know, you can work with that. Maybe the best thing would be to just announce that anyone that would like to testify should email me, because normally Faith doesn't just let people in without running it by me, to just email me. And I let anyone in. It's never been an issue. Anyone that wants to testify can testify. It's just timing it. So I know, Mike, do you have anything to add?
I don't. I support Kevin and Peggy's statements. I think your idea of having people email Faith if they want to be on the agenda is what we would do in real life. You know, we've always, like Senator Brock said, tried to replicate real life with this virtual life. And we didn't just blow the walls out of every committee room to do this. There's still confinements of how many people you can have on a Zoom meeting, how many tiles you can have on the screen, how many people Faith is keeping track of. And so I think what you've heard so far is completely accurate, is the best way forward, and I fully support it. And I won't keep you from your break.
No, we're finishing. We're early today. Okay, committee thoughts. Senator Ballin.
Just for the folks who might be watching at home, my understanding is a lot of the outreach that was done on this topic was from advocates and lobbyists, is that correct? And not from citizens who have wanted to testify and haven't been able to.
I think that the letters came from advocacy groups.
Okay, and I had seen them. I just didn't know if there had been another set of communiques from regular constituents. And so—
Probably know more than we do.
Yeah, exactly.
I have not.
Okay.
I have not seen that. No, and I, again, anyone that wants to testify, we let testify. There may be a delay but there is in real life anyway. There isn't, you know.
Well, and I think what Peggy says makes good sense. And to your point, Madam Chair, it's going to be important for Faith to be able to concentrate on meeting the needs of the committee and the chair. But if we can make a commitment to people that they will get a chance to testify, it may not be in real time, but that we will
we will fit them in so they'll be heard at a later time or day. It seems
what
fair.
Happens.
Yeah.
That's what happens. We post, Faith, do we send the agenda out or is it just posted?
I have a small group of people I send it to, mainly Ledge Council and other folks, just to be sure that they're aware that they may be needed. And otherwise, it's just posted. But as Peggy said, it's updated on a sort of day-by-day basis, and it's posted on Friday for the next Tuesday.
I think we used to send it out to a broader listserv, and maybe we, well, that could, we could try having tell people if they'd like to see the agenda. Can we put them on, just send out to more people?
We can do that. It's also so easy to get to from the legislative website that it seems sort of, I mean, if you thought it was important, I'm happy to do it, but it seems
no,
very-
No, I mean, if you're a lobbyist and getting paid to pay attention, then we probably shouldn't be doing your job for you. Okay, so committee, I'm seeing Senator Pearson's smiling face, but not hearing from him. At this point, you can think it over, but I think what I'm hearing is we'll just announce that, you know, anyone that wants to testify is free to just drop an email to me. I'll give them my email. We will, you know, we will get them in the next time we take up that issue. It sounds like we are going, this week I'm going to try and clear out a couple bills that I've been contacted about. One is dental insurance. The other one, despite what it is the Act 250 bill, and that was an issue with title insurance people. So we'll take a look at those. And then I'd like any other bills that, oh, there's the dog. Is that the puppy?
Yeah, sorry.
No, I have the picture of Officer Ramsey. I would like to make the official mascot of the committee. His picture will lower your blood pressure in 30 seconds or less. But anyway, Officer Ramsey is a canine officer who saved a lady who was foraging for mushrooms. He's a classic yellow lab who will calm anything. So anyway, that was my plan. Take a look at the bill still in committee. If you need a copy, I'm sure Faith can get it to you. These are two that I've been contacted about. Oh, we're also getting vapes out. That was on the list. I don't know what's happening with Act 250 at this point, but I thought I'd look at the title insurance guys who were just asking, how are they supposed to know if a road is 1,500 to 2,000 feet long, and they have to certify that whoever gets title of this piece of land is in compliance with Act 250. So we'll look at that. I think that's about it. For the rest of the session, I think we're going to be looking probably a lot at broadband. We're going to start with just an update of the grants that have gone out, the issues. Senator Kitchell, I think, sent us all a thing on, you know, what were the problems? Were there glitches or things in the system we set up that slowed things down? Issues like, can they get cable that have come up? So I was told that one company told the teacher who has to teach remotely that they weren't taking part in the line extension program. So they're not extending the line to her house unless she pays for all of it. And I gather that it isn't within their domain to do that. We can't make them. I did check that one with the commissioner, but I'd like to, any issues any of you have heard, and I again want to hear from the schools about, we have asked them to identify clusters of students and what are they doing with those students that can't access the internet. I did find out this morning with these child care hubs or pods. I see this kind of spaceshipy thing, but that students that can't get broadband will be able to go there, but I'm assuming it will cost their parents the estimated $125 a week to go there, unless they are below the 300% of poverty. But there's issues there with students, and what are we doing? And why aren't the schools paying for the pods or the, I don't know, a lot of it seems to be falling back on the shoulders of parents. So we can discuss that. Thoughts? All right, go forth and contemplate. Take a look at those bills. If there's anything you know we need to get out or you would like to get out. I think we're looking at H bills right now, unless it's been put on the list. So Senator Campion, you have, no, you were just turning your computer on or off, okay. I just see palm prints. All right. Okay. Thank you.
Ending live stream now.
We are going off live.